The Royal Pavilion is a spectacular palace in the centre of Brighton with a colourful history and a colourful interior to match. Built as a seaside pleasure palace for King George IV, it mixes Regency grandeur with Indian architecture and Chinese-inspired design. But have you ever wondered what's behind the scenes of the dazzling rooms and otherworldly interior? What stories are held by the large dome at the top of the palace, the secret underground tunnel, and the rooms behind concealed doors? I joined CEO Hedley Swain and curator Alexandra Loske to find out exactly that. Hedley, last time we were here, you promised me something. You said that I could come back and you would take me around the behind the scenes of the Royal Pavilion. I wasn't aware that there was so much to see behind the scenes.
There's loads, and there are different sorts of spaces. There are spaces that were once sort of formal parts of the pavilion that we would love eventually to bring back into use. We'll take you up into the dome, which is one of the most special places in the world, I think. And it would be lovely in time to have that open to the public again. We'll take you down into the basement, into the servants' quarters, into the storerooms. And again, really great spaces there. And of course, the famous tunnel. Everyone's heard of the secret tunnel. It's actually not that secret. It was the one that George used to get between the pavilion and his stables so that he wouldn't be seen by people.
His mistress, as a lot of people think.
No, I mean, there are all these different stories about there are lots of tunnels, and there's one tunnel, and it had a very specific use, and it was to get between the pavilion and the dome, which of course was the stables. We'll take you there. There's a bathroom. There was a king's bathroom. It's not a bathroom anymore. We use it for other things, but we'll show you that space. So yeah, lots and lots. And there's many more spaces that we won't get into. This is in a way, it's a nightmare of a building. The way it was built, there are lots of little passages and voids and areas that it's really difficult to get into that we have to look after. And we'll give you a glimpse maybe into some of those as well.
Great. Are we going to go through a secret door?
There may well be a secret door involved, yes.
Shall we?
Let's go. So here we are in the famous tunnel. So this tunnel, we've now, if you like, come out of the basement of the Royal Pavilion.
Right.
We've come through what we call the moat, which is a sunken area. And then the tunnel goes under the pavilion garden.
So we're under the pavilion garden
now? We're now under the garden. It goes for about 60 metres and emerges in the dome and museum complex. And this tunnel, it's not very deep. And there are light shafts up that we can look at. And once you know they're there, when you're up in the garden, you can look out.
Right.
You can look out for them.
So what was it built for?
Okay, so what would have happened is that the band, George's band would come in this way when they're going to perform. Other services would have come in, you know, goods and things. And then perhaps, you know, most poignantly, George would have used it to get from the pavilion to the stables to avoid the public seeing him. And it got to that point when, you know, George was very beautiful when he was a young man, very vain. It had got to the point where he was very overweight. He wasn't very healthy. He was often being mocked, and he didn't like being seen in public. And this was a way for him to quietly travel between his horses, which he absolutely adored, and the pavilion without being seen by the public.
So he was mocked by the public, by people who saw him, really.
You know, you would have seen all of those caricatures and cartoons at the time making fun of the fact that he'd become incredibly overweight, he was struggling to get on his horse, all sorts of things. Yeah.
So this is where he would walk?
Yeah, absolutely.
Shall we do the same?
The tunnel went out of use when the pavilion went out of use, and then they brought it back in the 1870s, and at that point, the first Brighton Museum was upstairs in the pavilion. And then when it outgrew that, they moved to the new museum building where it is now in the 1860s.
Right.
And then they used the tunnel again as the link between the museum and then a sort of overflow museum in the pavilion. And it's been open ever since, and it has been used for events. You know, there have in the past been events where you enter the museum and then, you know, come through here with a glass of champagne on your way to the pavilion. One of the things I would love to do is reintroduce this special tours and for events.
So the pavilion is there, the dome is there.
That's right.
We're going back to the pavilion.
Let's go back to the pavilion and let's look at the basement of the pavilion, Nash's pavilion and the earlier buildings. If you like, the downstairs bit of the pavilion, yeah. I'm going to leave you in the very safe hands of Alexandra Loske, one of our specialist curators, and I'll see you again upstairs later.
Alexandra, you're the curator of the Royal Pavilion. Can I be superficial to start with and just comment on your amazing piece of jewellery there?
Well, it's not mine, but I might well purchase one. This is a design by Tati Devine. And of course, we currently have the exhibition at Hove Museum of Tati Devine's jewellery and how they started out. And so we are now in the process of creating a whole range of pavilion
that's
related.
Beautiful. Well, I made an effort. My ring, I thought, looked like a dome.
Very nice. We'll come to the domes later on. But this is the first prototype that Tati Devine has designed
beautiful.
For us. And there'll be more. And they'll be soon in the shops.
So wonderful. Lovely. Yeah. Good. So we did a bit of marketing now. And tell me, where are we now? Hedley left me at the entrance to this part of the pavilion.
Mm-hmm. You've just been to the tunnel. That is at the north end of the pavilion, the last part to be built under George. And we're now walking into, we could call it the basement of the Royal Pavilion. So the music room is up there, on this side. And what you see here on this side is partly what the tunnel was for, is to bring in goods, to bring in messy things unseen without stepping on dainty Regency flower beds and so on. So things like wood would come through here and coal.
It actually says
you can
wood.
Just
I don't think
about,
the camera
you can just be... about see the lettering, which may or may not be Georgian.
Right.
But there's certainly a good age to these doors.
Mm.
And they're still used as storerooms. In municipal times, this was used for other things, including in the mid-20th century as an air raid shelter.
Right.
As were so many sort of subterranean areas of Brighton.
So people would actually, would they stay the night here for...
Yes, quite possibly, doing air raids, both here in these storerooms as well as in the tunnel.
Right.
So it's really exciting being able to show you the basement, because what you see here is also how the building developed from the 18th and then into the 19th century. So let me just show you where the two centuries meet. We're now stepping into it, okay? And some of the flagstones, some of the stones in this corridor are original, but what I'd really like to show you is this area.
Mm.
This is what we call the undercroft, and this is where you see Henry Holland's foundations. So we're now seeing more of Holland's pavilion, but the really exciting part is through there. And now you can hear the people walking above us.
Yeah.
So, careful with your head. So, I've brought you into one of the oldest parts of the Royal Pavilion here. And what you notice immediately...
This is a semicircular shape. Not that you can see it from outside, can you?
Only if you look really, really carefully.
Uh-huh.
Because where we are now is one of the oldest parts of the Royal Pavilion. So when Henry Holland built this first marine pavilion for George in the 1780s, it looked elegant and neoclassical, nothing what we see now.
Wow.
That is all John Nash, all the trellis work and the domes, the minarets, all of that is John Nash. So the first marine pavilion that George lived in had this neoclassical look. And that included a bow-fronted east front.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, we see that a lot. We see bay windows in Brighton, but we also see bow windows.
We
so
do.
They are semicircular.
Right.
And Nash, of course, have covered all of that up and extended. But here we are in the basement, and these are Henry Holland's foundations, where we still see that beautiful semicircular shape, which is why we still call the bedrooms on the chamber floor the ballrooms, the yellow ballrooms.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. This is what the building looked like in the 1780s. So, and we are basically here.
Right, okay. So these are the semicircular, so there are two and two on the other side.
So we are in this one.
I can see how excited you are to be in this room. Is there any chance of opening it up for the public at some stage?
Possibly, yes. I mean, it's a very complex area. So this wall, for example, was put in later, and we need to think about health and safety, but it is possible. Mm. We have done it in the past, and I think Hedley has plans to do sort of behind-the-scenes tours and hidden pavilion tours in the future again.
So what's Nash Boiler?
Ah, boilers. Now, boilers are really important in this building because it had underfloor heating, but George also had a bathroom that is unlike normal people's bathrooms.
Really?
It included several baths, including something more like a small swimming pool. Oh. And he had hot running water in this building. So there were several boilers in the basement. And one of them heated his various baths. And I'd like to show you his bathroom now.
Oh, I'd love to see that. Okay, so now we're back at the pavilion. Which part is this?
This is the king's bedroom.
Right, so and somewhere in the king's bedroom there's a secret door.
There are several secret doors,
really?
But I'm going to show you the most exciting one.
Okay.
So come with me. And what looks like a wall actually contains what we call a jib door.
Mm.
Hidden. And it's not so much a secret, but it sort of blends in with the decoration.
Blends in.
Mm-hmm. And behind this was George's bathroom. And it's not like a bathroom that you or I know from our houses, from our homes. This was more like a private spa.
Oh.
A small swimming pool included.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. Sadly, none of this is left, but the room is still here.
Exciting.
Okay.
Oh,
shall we go in?
Wow. Ah, so no bath.
Sadly not.
Is it paper?
It's beautiful things. We now store in this room
some
of the paper archives. Mm. So, for example, our fragments of Chinese wallpaper and some other things from the conservation department. So people work in here.
Right.
None of the interior fixtures and fittings of George's bathroom survive, but we do know quite a lot about it.
So what do we know about it? You said it was very unusual, not a bath that I would think of as a bath.
Well, he was the Prince Regent and then King. Of course, he did everything bigger and better than everybody else. So much of this room was taken up by something you can't really call a bathtub. It was a plunge bath, a marble plunge bath with mahogany railings and steps just about here, steps going down into that really miniature swimming pool, which was fed with either hot or cold water. So there was somewhere near here, underground, an additional boiler, and we don't know where exactly that was. So in addition to the huge marble plunge bath with the steps going into it, he also had smaller bathtubs, and he had vapour and steam baths, which were sort of constructions where you were attached to a device that would heat up the water, sort of miniature boiler, and you would get put into it and then tied into it.
Oh,
basically
goodness.
Like the steam room we know today, but for one person. So you sit on this little stool. Just after the Second World War, things were beginning to progress in the Royal Pavilion. So we had very good sort of keepers and directors, and they started doing more in the pavilion, more restoration work happened. And in the 1960s, this room was turned into a shop.
The Royal Pavilion shop.
The Royal Pavilion
before
shop.
Before it moved to the other side.
Yes. And it was decorated by a man who was working here as a conservator and an artist called Roy Bradley. Fantastic sort of historic figure in the history of the Royal Pavilion.
Mm.
And he painted this. And it's quite whimsical in parts. So he gives us this sort of window onto Brighton, sort of an imagined Brighton scene. And he also turns this into, well, a tent, sort of a trellis, a greenhouse, yes. something. So it's he paints trellis and we see vine, we see roses, we see bindweed. So it's all rather lovely. And it has that sort of great post-war feel, something new and better is happening. This is just one of many examples of the things that get given to curators by the conservators. And it's just very appropriate to look at these here because these are dragons. And there you go, aren't they wonderful? So they're carved from wood and then they are painted and glazed and silvered and gilt. So we have everything on here. Mm. We have silver leaf, we have gold leaf. So this is the kind of thing we store here because they're really important in the history of the Royal Pavilion, but also lots of plans and maps, not just of the royal period.
And this piece of wallpaper, what is that?
Well, it's an early piece of a fragment of Chinese wallpaper, and we know exactly where it used to be.
Where?
Because you can tell where certain sort of pictures were hanging or certain pieces of furniture were sort of in the room.
So now we're going to the?
We're going to the chamber floor, and we're going to go to the most exciting hidden area, which is right next to where this piece of wallpaper used to hang.
Ah, and there's Hedley again with some hats for us.
With some hats. You had a good time downstairs.
Fantastic.
Now we're going as far up as we can go, up into the main dome, or bottle dome as we call it.
Wow, I've been waiting for this moment. Okay, I'm going to follow Alex to the dome.
So this is such an incredible space.
It is so incredible. And, you know, it's exciting on so many levels. First of all, because I don't think I know anybody who's been here.
Okay.
But also because we are inside the dome that is the emblem, really,
yeah,
the main
dome that is the thing that is most recognisable and is on, again and again, on logos. It's on Brighton and Hove City Council's, you know, emblem.
Yes.
And the thing that makes it so recognisable as the pavilion are these really distinct windows.
They are
which,
so beautiful.
Which you see again and again.
Mm.
The other thing about this, it's as it was left in 1850, and it's a reminder that when Queen Victoria sold the Royal Pavilion, they took everything out because they thought probably it was going to be demolished, and it was full of actually beautiful
yeah.
things. So a lot of the wallpaper went, all of the furnishings went, even the fireplaces went. And this room, and you can see the fireplace, you know, ripped off the wall, is how it would have been left in 1850. And I think, you know, we would love to make this space again open to the public. It's not safe for large numbers at the moment, but we hope we will be able to do that. And if we did, I think it would be nice to leave it like this.
So people could see what
exactly.
actually the whole place would have been
exactly.
like.
Exactly.
Which would have been very sad.
Yeah. But it's also, then if you go back a period, when it was built and designed, it was, these were working rooms. They were
right.
guest rooms for a while. Later they were servants' rooms.
So and that's quite unusual for the servants to be at the top of the place.
Well, you squeeze them in wherever you can,
right.
kind of thing. And, you know, remembering that, you know, the pavilion is not that big a building and is primarily a few very specific state rooms for parties and then kitchens and servants' rooms around them. You also get wonderful views of Brighton and see how Brighton has changed, and the story is that Queen Victoria actually here stood and watched fireworks on one occasion. And there's also the story that one of her complaints about the pavilion is you couldn't see the sea. And it's that classic thing, why would you live at the sea if you can't see the sea? And it is in fact, a fact that, you know, you really struggle if you stand on tiptoe and, you know, look around the trees. But on the whole, ironically, the Royal Pavilion at Brighton at the sea doesn't have good views of the sea.
And she didn't like that.
She observed it, but it was rather odd that that was the case.
Yeah, I can see the point.
The last thing here, which brings it right up to date, if you look carefully, there is graffiti everywhere.
Yes.
And a lot of it is clearly workmen. People have worked at different places, you know, there are calculations and things. But clearly, after a while, it just became one of those things you did. And right. there's lots and lots of graffiti going all the way back into the 19th century, if you look closely. And you could spend a whole day just going around looking at all the different...
Any interesting messages that you're aware of?
There are lots. Some of them you don't want to look at too closely.
Oh, no, I do.
There are some ones that are quite sort of rude about, you know, the amount of money that's been spent here and things like that. And then just as you always get with graffiti, just people wanting to leave their mark.
So, Alexandra, Hedley showed me around part of the dome. It's so much bigger than I actually thought. And said that he was really hoping that one day it would be open for the public, but would not turn into the sort of grand style of, you know, the rest of the building, but for people to actually see the kind of authentic dome. What can you tell me about the history of this part of the pavilion?
Well, we are, as I say, in the largest of the bulbous domes, and they were added by John Nash. And in fact, this part went up in 1818. So he built the music room and the banqueting room first, these sort of square rooms with the tent-shaped roofs. And then he added all the small bulbous domes and the big one in the centre. So we're actually above what was the shallow dome in the 18th century. So in order to put this big dome onto the existing building, John Nash had to use cast iron in a really creative and bold way. So it's like a huge birdcage sitting on top of Henry Holland's building, or around Henry Holland's building. And this is an example of this. So this is actually a hollow column, but behind it is part of the cast iron structure that John Nash needed to create this.
Right. And what's over there? There's a wooden contraption.
Yes, well, there's lots of small rooms now, but the original plans for this space were something on a grander scale.
Right.
And we don't know exactly, but it's possible that George wanted to use this as a billiard room, which never happened. There's still rumours going around that there was a billiard table up here. And how would you have got a billiard table up to this level?
No.
Well, maybe through this room. If you're standing in the garden of the Royal Pavilion and you take some time and you look beyond all the onion-shaped domes and the minarets, and you see two towers, and they look rather Gothic.
Mm.
And that's quite common, to combine the Oriental style with the Gothic or the Neo-Gothic style. And we've come up one of these towers. And that obviously has that terrifying spiral staircase in it. And the other one is there for symmetry, and that's just through there. But it also had a winch in it. And it's a drop down to the next floor down.
Wow, I can't thank you enough. This has been so exciting. And in a way, I feel quite, happy about being one of the few that has had the opportunity to see these places. But it would be fantastic, as you say, Hedley, if somehow it could be made more accessible to the public. And Alexandra, I know you're just about to start writing a book about the interiors of the Royal Pavilion. Maybe just tell me a little bit about that.
Yes, this is a lovely new project, and I'm so glad this comes to fruition now that the new trust is in place. So I'm going to write a book for Yale University Press about the interiors of the Royal Pavilion. So things like this wallpaper here are of great interest to me. So that's going to take roughly 2 years, and it should be beautiful and sumptuous and really tell the world how wonderful and extraordinary this building is.
Any more secrets to come out of the secret places in the book?
Quite possibly. Of course, we started with the necklace. Of course, we're now in this dome. We're now
of course
in this
we are.
Dome.
There are the windows.